Praise the Lord. Won't you just lift your hands? We're getting ready to have our preaching service, but I want you to understand that what you feel right now, I just want you to keep that in your heart. We're getting ready to talk in words what we just seen with our eyes, and I just pray that you will be blessed as we choose to bless Jesus here today. Praise the Lord. If you have your Bibles, we're going to get into the message. We're going to start with Exodus 12, and we're going to do verse 13 for our opening text. The Bible says, "And the blood shall be to you for a token upon the houses where you are. And when I see the blood, I will pass over you. And the plague shall not be upon you to destroy you when I smite the land of Egypt." I want to talk to us briefly this morning about blood, hope, and resurrection. Let's go to the Lord in prayer together. Heavenly Father God, we are so fortunate that we have had the opportunity to be here today, that we might see the greatest story, the passion, unfolding before our very eyes. I pray that by the end of this preaching time, that each and every one of us will take what has happened, we'll see that it is available to us today, and that we will choose to make you our Lord and our King. God bless this message and bless this audience in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you. Please be seated. Blood, hope, and resurrection. According to God's word, we are all sinners and we could not save ourselves. Going back to the Garden of Eden, men had a choice, and they made the wrong choice. We have no hope if we had no Savior.
That's right.
We cannot save ourselves, and someone must provide an answer to this crisis.
That's right.
How is it that men were created to be eternal, to live in paradise with the Most High and the Most Holy God, and then because of the choice that man made, we lose paradise, we lose life, and we have no hope?
Right.
You see, from the original creation account, that was never God's plan for man. God was created that he might worship and love and be a part of what God was doing.
Right.
But man made choices, and true love is a choice. I want you to understand that. True love is being able to choose to walk away when you choose to stay.
Right.
And so God gave man that choice, and man made the wrong choice. So now we're in a dilemma. How can we be saved? We have no hope, then we have no purpose. If we live only to die, where is the beauty in the life that we live?
Right.
Death is the ultimate defeat. It is powerless. It is the greatest motivator. It motivates us to live our best days every day, to work diligently that we might realize our dreams,
right,
because life is like a vapor, and one day we all know that death is coming. The finality of death is far from a dream for many people. Those that have never met Jesus, death is a great nightmare. It's never a dream. Death inspires the best in us and the worst in us. If living is dying, what horror. We have no hope. Death, thank God, is destroyed by life. The Bible is clear that we are unable to make right our own disobedience. Justice declared our guilt, and mercy shouted for our innocence. Our dilemma is salvation, a people that have lost everything, yet they have the privilege to gain it back. How does that happen? Why should I be allowed in heaven when born into sin and living the way that I live, looking myself in the mirror? I know the man that I am. Why should I be allowed the promise of heaven? What is the right answer that I seek? How can I die and have an assurance that when I die and pass from this life to the next, that it's not final, that it's not a nightmare, that it's a matter of fact, it's a dream come true? My faith tells me there's got to be more than this. Even the man that's lost, if he's honest, will tell you it can't be over when a man dies. They don't know what's next. They don't know what the next step is. And for thousands of years, men have wondered, what's next? To lay down and to never rise again. What's next? Going back to the Exodus story, to be delivered from Egypt, the Israelites were instructed by God to put the blood of the lamb on their doorpost. We're going to do Exodus 12, 3 through 9. It says, "Speak ye unto all the congregation of Israel." This is God commanding Moses. "In the 10th day of the month they shall take every man a lamb according to the house of their fathers." A lamb for an house. "And if the household be too little for the lamb, let him and the neighbor next to his house take it according to the number of souls. Every man according to his eating shall make you count for the lamb. Your lamb shall be without blemish, a male of the first year. You shall take it out from the sheep or from the goats. And you shall keep it until the 14th day of the month. And the whole assembly of the congregation of Israel shall kill it in the evening. And they shall take of the blood and strike it on the two side posts and on the upper door post of the house wherein they shall eat." I'm going to stop a minute. The Israelites are enslaved in the land of Egypt. This is before the tabernacle plan. This is before the daily reminder of bloodshed that told them that the ugliness of sin carried a high cost and carried a great burden. They are being instructed that they have to shed blood and they have to put blood across the doorposts of their home. "They shall take of it, strike it on the two sides of the post, on the upper doorpost of the house wherein they shall eat." And then Exodus 12 and 8 says, "And they shall eat the flesh in that night, roast with fire and unleavened bread, and with bitter herbs they shall eat it. Eat not of it raw, nor sodden it all with water, but roast it with fire, his head with his legs, and with purtons therefore." The death angel passed over every home that applied the blood, the Bible says, in Exodus 12, 11 through 13, and 21 through 23. Now what does that mean to us today? God was beginning to show them the importance of the blood. And the power of the blood, the innocent blood, the blood from the male without blemish, the lamb that was chosen and raised specifically for the purpose to die, brought into the earth so that he might one day die, so that men that were deserving of death could have their sins rolled forward. God's beginning to introduce them to this process. Dr. David Bernard writes it this way. We see typology here. The lamb without blemish signifies perfection. The unleavened bread signifies sinlessness. The bitter herbs symbolizes suffering. When they eat it completely, that means they received everything and they received it totally. The Bible commanded them to be ready to travel. And he says instant separation and obedience. Accepting it, passing over, the death angel did. Their children were spared. And then they were instantly ready to be obedient to God from that point forward.
That's right.
They had seen a great supernatural occurrence happen, and they were let go and set free by the power of God. You have to understand that. When you look at the Exodus story and the plagues and all the power that God displayed so that he might free his people, he is going overwhelmingly overboard to show you that it was not Moses, it was not Aaron, it was not politics, it was not leadership, it was the mighty power of God in all of its supernatural glory and supernatural display that freed those people from that bondage. The Israelites' deliverance became a permanent reality as they passed through the cloud and the sea. And we see that in Exodus 13 and 14. They, like us today, were sentenced to death because of their sin. But we see God beginning to make a way. The plan that is as old as the ages is beginning to take shape in our sight if we're reading the Word of God. Romans 3:23 says, "All have sinned and come short of the glory of God." And Romans 6:23 says, "The wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord." The Bible makes plain there must be a sacrifice, a shedding of blood, an atonement for the sin of men. The sin of men have kept us separated from God, and God had to find that perfect lamb without blemish, born into the world specifically to die, that those that he was substituting for might not ever have to taste the death that was going to be forced upon this innocent man. Hebrews 9:22 says, "And almost all things by the law purged with blood. Without shedding of blood, there is no remission." There had to be bloodshed. John 1:29 says, "The next day John, seeing Jesus coming unto him, saith, Behold the Lamb of God, which taketh away the sin of the world." So the Israelites have gone for hundreds of years. They saw the bloodshed and the Passover where God spared them supernaturally. Even though they saw the miracles of God and they had heeded the command of God, they failed. Their sin nature took root in their life. They had ups, they had downs, they had ins, they had outs. Like us, they had good days, and like us, they had bad days. They had those days when God was real to them and those days when they felt God was far away. They lived their lives like we live our lives, and they realized the pain of trial and tribulation, and yet instilled in their uttermost being and at the core of who they were, they knew that they were missing something, and they cried for a day when God would answer the question of sin. So we see in John this man coming, and we see John see Jesus coming, and he looks at him and he says, "Behold the Lamb of God, which taketh away the sin of the world." The Jews remembered the Passover, no doubt. In their mind, they remembered the sacrificial system and the tabernacle and all that they were required to do that they might appease the wrath of God for that day when the Messiah would come and put to rest all of their ignorance and all of their silliness and all of the sin that they had done in their life. 1 Corinthians 5 and 7 says, "Purge out therefore the old leaven, that ye may be a new lump as ye are unleavened. For even Christ our Passover is sacrificed for us." This is the Apostle Paul, who knew the Old Testament. He was a scholar of its pages. He's saying Jesus Christ is our Passover. You can look at the Passover and the remitting of the blood, and the blood that remained on the doorpost that the death angel might spare the lives therein. He's saying Jesus Christ is our Passover. He was sacrificed for us. We are saved by the blood. And the blood is what has set us free. And the grace of God and His mercy purchased that right for us. It was nothing we could do, nothing we could do to save ourselves. Isaiah said, "Our righteousness is filthy rags. It's nothing compared to God." If we hope to be anything in this world, it is that we might be as close to Jesus Christ as we can be. That we might emulate His life. That we might model His character. That we might teach as He taught. And that we might walk as He walked. And live as He lived. Faith is not just some mental assent. It requires obedience to God. What does that mean? It means when you come to that place in your life where it's finally been said, the word has finally gone forth, and you finally receive it. It finally all makes sense. That's when you realize that Jesus Christ loves me, and all the things that that preacher or all the things that that teacher or all the things the Word of God has said is true. And when you come to that place in your life where you realize you're lost, and when you realize God is the only hope that you have, it is at that time that we are required to be obedient. Hebrews 11:28 says, "Though through faith he," referring to Moses, "kept the Passover and the sprinkling of blood, lest he that destroyed the firstborn should touch them." What that's showing is that God had given Moses the promise and the plan, but Moses carried out the promise and the plan. If Moses had simply said, "Okay, God, I believe you," but he was unwilling to train Israel, to show them what lamb to pick out, to shed the blood and apply it to the doorpost, then he would not have been saved. He and his children and those children in Israel, would have all died as a result of his lack of obedience. True faith is not simply coming to some mental knowledge. It is acting from that mental knowledge. It is passion pushing you to take that next step in your faith. Moses responded to the promise by being obedient to God's command. And he did exactly as God had told him to do. Do you know that we have a plan today? That God has a purpose today that we might also make application when we come to that place in our life, when we realize that God has done exactly as God said He would, and now I want to get my heart and get my life right with the Almighty God. That is Acts 2:38, and it says, "Peter said unto them, as he had preached the inaugural message of the church, Christ had gone back to heaven, and now he is telling them how they might be saved. He said, 'Be baptized, repent, be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sins, and you shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost.'" 2 Corinthians 5 and 17 says, "Therefore, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. Old things passed away. Behold, all things are become new." You don't have to live that way anymore. "And all things are of God, who hath reconciled us to himself by Jesus Christ, and hath given us the ministry of reconciliation." And verse 19 says, to wit, that God was in Christ reconciling the world unto himself, not imputing their trespasses unto them, and hath committed unto us the word of reconciliation. 2 Corinthians 5:20 says, now then we are ambassadors for Christ. As though God did beseech you by us, we pray you in Christ's stead, be reconciled unto God. That's Him making the appeal. Be reconciled to God. It really is your choice. It really is your opportunity. Jesus Christ paid the price, but you have the opportunity to be like Jesus is. 2 Corinthians 5:21 says, for He hath made Him to be sin for us who knew no sin, that we might be made righteous of God in Him. Applying the blood of Jesus Christ through baptism and being infilled with the Holy Spirit. God's promise is the same to us. When I see the blood, I will pass over you. What can wash away my sin? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. You just heard that on a song. Maybe you've never heard of Jesus, but Jesus was born during a time of the Roman reign in Jerusalem, which was the holy city. And He was the seed of David. He lived at the time of the second temple. King Herod attempted to win favor with the Jewish people by allowing them the privilege to rebuild the temple that had been destroyed. But they now lived under occupation. Angels announced His birth, and He became Jesus of Nazareth. He could, in His own right, have proclaimed to be the King, but they asked, can anything good come out of Nazareth? He said Himself that He literally owned nothing. The King, the God in Christ, robed in flesh, the Godhead being full in Jesus Christ. And yet He said He literally had nothing. He says, foxes have dens and birds have nests, but the Son of Man has no place to lay His head. He was the most precious birth in human history. Simeon and Anna recognized His significance as His birth was answered prayer and prophecy fulfilled. They celebrated Jesus. After His circumcision, He and His family were running for His life. They went to Egypt to escape the wrath of God. Herod dies and the family returns fulfilling prophecy. We see Him amaze the scholars in the temple at the age of 12. And they could not understand His understanding and His answers being just a young boy. Jesus goes into the temple one day and He reads. And we're going to look at Luke 4:18-19. Jesus says, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me because He hath anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. He hath sent me to heal the brokenhearted, to preach deliverance to the captives, recovering of sight to the blind, to set at liberty them that are bruised, and to preach the acceptable year of the Lord. And He would fulfill each and every word. He recruits disciples, those that would follow Him, men that He had selected specifically because He knew their faults, but yet He knew that they would be there when He needed them most. He teaches like no one else. He had such knowledge, yet even little ones could understand Him in the way that He taught. In His simplicity, the parable of the fig tree, all of the parable of the sower, many of the parables would follow. He would teach them, and they would realize there's just something different about Jesus. He walks on water, fed 5,000, another 4,000, plus women and children, specialized in performing miracles. He healed the sick, transformed the lame, delivered the captive, the man at Bethesda, 10 lepers. He exorcised demons from the demoniac. He raised a mother-in-law to health. Jairus' daughter came back to life. That is who Jesus was. He fulfilled every word of that prophecy that He read in the temple. Certain nobleman's son forever changed. His words calmed the raging sea and restored a centurion's servant. He made His home with outcasts and refused a reputation that He rightfully deserved. He raised people above wrath and He treated people, mercy above judgment. He treated people as He loved people. And He loved people that we might see His example and we might also do likewise. Stones were readied at the throw, but He showed mercy. The woman with the issue of blood came through the crowd and just grabbed hold of the hem of His garment that she might have her disease healed, and it was. He taught the disciples to pray and declared that they would perform greater works than He did. Blind Bartimaeus, Mary Magdalene, the rich young ruler Zacchaeus. He was a king and yet He washed feet. He lowered Himself to that of a servant to teach us the value of service, to teach us the value of being a servant ourselves, that we might mimic Him in our relationships to others, that we might love beyond all that we are capable of loving. He was the most loyal, yet He was the most betrayed. He was the most uplifting figure in history, but He was humiliated. and discouraged as we've seen here today. He had a job to do, and he was unwilling to compromise. He was brutalized, he was destroyed, he was broken, and he was murdered, and yet he did all that and thought that was a worthy and willing price to pay that you might be saved. You know, when Peter preached at the first day of the church, he preached essentially that Jesus is dead. He is the Messiah that you all killed. But thank God he's been risen. He is risen to newness of life. He has fulfilled the role of the Messiah. He is the King that we have searched for. And when the Bible says they were pricked in their hearts because they realized the truth that Peter preached as he spoke in authority over them. He's dead and you killed him. That's what he said. No, the Bible says Jesus came and laid down his life willingly that our sin might be remitted. He was the one that ushered in the testament of grace and mercy. His blood was shed. Do you know that the fact that he came into the world that sin might be remitted means that I could say the same thing to you today that Peter said to them. Jesus Christ died, his blood was shed, and you killed him. But the most beautiful part of that is how Peter finished when he said that the promises to you and to your children and to all who are afar off, that Jesus Christ is not locked away in the grave, but he's been resurrected. He is the Messiah, the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords. He is the great, the Almighty, and the All-Powerful. Though his blood was shed that your sins might be remitted, he was resurrected that you too might be resurrected, that you might have hope. In Jesus' name. Acts 10:38 says, how God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Ghost and with power, who went about doing good and healing all that were oppressed of the devil, for God was with him. Verse 39 says, and we are witnesses of all things which he did, both in the land of the Jews and in Jerusalem, whom they slew and hanged on a tree. We are witnesses of those things. Him God raised up the third day, the next verse, and showed him openly. Born as a king, yet refusing his reputation. A.W. Tozer, many of you are familiar with him, he says it this way, if man had his way, the plan of redemption would be an endless and bloody conflict. In reality, salvation was bought not by Jesus' fist, but by his nail-pierced hands. Not by muscle, but by love. Not by force, but by sacrifice. Jesus Christ our Lord surrendered in order that we might win. He destroyed his enemies by dying for them. Think about that. He destroyed his enemies by dying for them and conquered death by allowing death to conquer him. Think about that. 1 Corinthians 15:3 says, for I have delivered unto you first of all that which I have also received. Paul's writing, how that Christ died for our sins according to the Scripture. And the next verse says, and that he was buried and that he rose again the third day according to the Scriptures. Paul would later write in his letter to the Philippians 3:7, it says, But what things were gained to me, those I counted loss for Christ. Yea, and doubtless, and I count all things but loss for the excellency of the knowledge of Christ Jesus my Lord, for whom I have suffered the loss of all things, and do count them but dung, that I may win Christ, and be found in him, not having mine own righteousness which is of the law, but that which is through the faith of Christ, the righteousness which is of God by faith. And Philippians 3:10, the first verse, first line, that I may know him and the power of his resurrection. See, Paul knew those Old Testament scriptures. He knew what to look for in a Messiah. He knew one day God was going to send that chosen child into the world. And that chosen child was going to come into the world and he was going to right the wrongs that men themselves could not right. He himself is familiar with the sacrificial system and all the bloodshed. And he himself looked forward to the day when the Messiah would come before he ever knew Jesus Christ to be that Messiah. But do you realize when he says the power of his resurrection, he had seen those events. He had heard and witnessed. It says there were 500 witnesses that were alive at the time of the writing that he could question about their experience, what they had seen and what they had heard, and how Jesus had made an impact on their life. He knew the day was coming that blood would be shed that he might be saved along with everyone else. And that's him saying that nothing in life matters except we know Jesus, that I may know him and the power of his resurrection. The Bible in Acts 5 talks about how there were men that had come and proclaimed themselves some glorious position, but they failed. It's where they're taking counsel to decide what they're going to do with Peter because he keeps preaching in the name of Jesus. I believe it's him and John, but they're preaching. And they say, what are we going to do with these? Well, the old man gets up, Gamaliel, I believe is what his name was, but I may be wrong. He stands up and says, if this thing be of God, then you're going to be fighting against God. But if this thing is not of God, then they themselves, it'll cease on its own. They'll go away. And he's the one that told the stories of these others that had come and proclaimed all this glory, and then they went away. And so he's saying that if this is the man, then we have to let these men alone. The power of his resurrection. They too looked to the day when blood would be shed that they might forever be free. Now they didn't quite understand the scripture. Many of them had studied it many days and they looked for a Messiah to come and usher in a military victory. They didn't realize all the bloodshed would come and that he would be humiliated, that they might be purged from their sin. If they had read their Bible closely and if they had looked at it the way they should have, the scripture that they had, they would have known it, but they missed it. But what's most important today is that these men that we just mentioned a moment ago, they fell to the wayside. God was not in them. But this man, Jesus, was completely different. He came and he taught and he lived and he died. But you know what the difference was? He was resurrected. This is the first man and the only man that came back to life, that his blood was shed. We saw it, they said. We saw everything that happened. The disciples, I'm sure, heard the story. John watched it in person as he saw his Savior die, and everything they thought was over. You know, the Bible says they went back to their old lives. Even they hadn't yet got it, though they'd been with Jesus for over 3 years. But then they saw him, and he was alive. What's most important today is not that you've enjoyed your time here in the form of entertainment, but that you realize that all men have hope. That the blood has purchased that hope, and that all men have the promise of a resurrection. All you have to do is be willing to accept what Jesus Christ has done for you and to allow Jesus Christ to be the Lord of your life. What's most important today is not that you leave here and you talk about how good the message was, how nice the music was. What's most important is that you leave here and say, Mama, Daddy, I found Jesus today. I felt Jesus today. I saw Jesus today. He touched me in a special way. And I give my heart to Jesus because your life will never be the same. Please stand with me. Let us pray together. If you would, bow your heads. Heavenly Father, God, I thank you that we have the privilege today to be here. God, I consider it an honor that we have such free access to assembly that we can come and hear the precious words of God preached. That we can come, Lord, and that we can read your word, and most of us have a copy at home. And God, we're such blessed folks. But God, I pray today that we realize that we must have our hearts and our lives right with you. That we know the words of God and we've heard them spoke over us today, Lord Jesus. But I pray that we'll do something with it today. That we won't leave this place until we are right with you, God. That if it requires repentance, that we'll repent. If we've never been baptized, God, help us to do it today, not tomorrow. God, if it be your will, pour out your Spirit, God, and fill someone with the Holy Ghost today, Lord. I believe all things are possible in the name of Jesus. And I believe that the resurrection is the greatest story ever told. And God, I just pray that you'll prick hearts today and that you'll bless this congregation in a special way in the name of Jesus. Amen. Please come. We'll pull the altars out. Brother Michael, if some of you men could come, help us pull the altars out here. We'd like to have the altars available, so anyone would like to kneel, please do. Come and let's pray together. In the name of Jesus.
The blood that Jesus shed for me. Oh. gives me strength from day to day. It will never lose its power. Oh, it soothes my doubts and it calms my fears. It reaches
Praise the Lord, everybody. Why don't you give the Lord a big hand clap today? Praise the Lord. Well, I know we've got an egg hunt here today, and I just wish, Pastor, would you come up, just greet the congregation, and we'll get the details of that together, and I'll come back up.
Praise the Lord. Amen. Praise the Lord, everybody. Anybody excited about living for the Lord? Man, boy, I tell you what, God, people feel better feeling bad than the world does when they feel good. Amen. Thank you so much. Brother Mark, thank you so much for helping me out this morning. I had to make a snappy decision, real quick decision. I told Sister Norton yesterday, give me just a minute if you would. And Sister Willingham was doing much better. But then last night, Brother Willingham called me about between 7:30 and 8 o'clock this morning. And said last night she got hurt real bad in her leg. And so they came in and gave her some coating. And she rested a little bit. And then this morning, she said she was just screaming, hurt so bad in her leg. Brother Willingham got the feeling of the bottom part of her leg up pretty close to her thigh. And it was real hard. And so he got the nurses in there, and the blood is that she's been losing. They have given her, nine pints of blood this week. And the blood is settling in her leg. They was concentrating on the upper part, thinking she was bleeding, and they couldn't find the bleeding, but she's bleeding down low. And so the blood, so they're trying now to decide what they're going to do. And I could tell he was really hurting this morning. I asked him, I said, Brother Willingham, do you need me to come on back down there, or come down there? And he said, well, he said, I hate to have you to miss your service. He said, but you sure would be welcome. So I started making phone calls and told Brother Mark, I said, just, you know, get whatever you can. And I'm glad he didn't have 3 days today. Thank you, Brother Mark, for this working. And thank you, Sister Creasy, for helping me put it together. I want to thank all the young people, Sherry and Michelle and Rebecca, them for just, it's good to know that when, if you have to be out, you know, everything will carry on.
Amen.
And thank you for the, Hannah, wherever you're at, that was beautiful today. Thank you to those young people. Amen. Stanley, thank you for helping us out with building walls. And everybody had a part of this. Thank you so much. And I thank all of our guests for being here. Amen. Appreciate it. Okay, the little one, I think I know, you help me out. The little class, which is Michelle's and Rebecca's class, is going to be in the back. Back here, so they got signs out there. The next class is going to be over on this side, top of the hill, right? 5 to 7, and then from 7 to 5 to 7 is on this side over here, and the rest is on this side over here. The teachers will be outside the door waiting. I can't understand it. You got to talk.
If y'all have a basket, I got to
okay. If you don't have anything to put eggs in, Sister Michelle's got bags back there. And so stay with your class.
Please don't let your child start hunting until everyone has got out there.
Everybody listen up. Don't let the children start hunting until all the classes are there. Right. Okay, all the teachers, you teachers that's going to be a part of it, go on out in each class. And no service here tonight. Enjoy the time and be back here Wednesday night. Everybody say praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
God bless you. You're dismissed in the name of the Lord.